Stranger in the dark, the lonely night. How'd your mother call it?
The first cases of forensic odontology date back to the Roman Empire, where it was used to identify slaves. A famous case was during the reign of Emperor Claudius, when the emperor's second wife, Agrippina, had her predecessor, Lollia Paulina, murdered while she was hiding in Spain. To prove she really was dead, the soldiers took the head of Lollia Paulina to Rome. However, during the long journey, the head had started to decompose, making it impossible to recognize. Agrippina was able to identify her rival using forensic odontology. Cassius wrote she opened the mouth with her own hand and inspected the teeth, which had certain peculiarities.
The anterior teeth of the Norman king, William the Conqueror, were misaligned. He would use this to his advantage and to bite soft wax to leave an imprint of his teeth and then attach it to his letters, confirming their authenticity.
Another famous case where forensic dentistry provided key evidence was during the infamous Salem witch trials of 1692. Reverend George Burroughs was accused of witchcraft and conspiring with the devil, with biting his victims supposedly being evidence of his crimes. His bite marks and the bite evidence of other people were compared to the victims' marks. The judges readily accepted the bite marks as evidence, and this was the first time in what would become the United States that bite marks were used as evidence to solve a crime. He was later convicted and hanged. About two decades later, he was exonerated by the state, and his children compensated for the wrongful execution.
Forensic odontology also provided key evidence in the 1979 trial of the notorious serial killer, rapist, and psychopath Ted Bundy, where forensic odontologists compared impressions of the bite wounds Bundy had inflicted on the left buttock of one of his victims and matched them with castings of Bundy's teeth. He was convinced to the murder and rape of 36 women and sentenced to death by electrocution. However, the sentence was only carried out 10 years later.
After the end of World War II, there were rumors Adolf Hitler had escaped with his wife Eva Braun to Argentina. Actually, they had died together in 1945. However, their bodies had been burned and then buried by Soviet soldiers due to lack of antemortem and postmortem records. It was a challenge to dispel the rumors they were still alive. Finally, pieces of Hitler's mandible were found that revealed remnants of a bridge as well as unusual forms of reconstruction to the mandible with evidence of periodontal disease. Adolf Hitler's identity was confirmed when the work matched the records kept by his dentist Hugo Blaschke.
Another Nazi SS officer identified thanks to forensic dentistry was Dr. Joseph Mengele, also known as the Angel of Death, for his despicable experiments on the inmates of Auschwitz-Birkenau concentration camp. He escaped punishment and hid in Paraguay under a false name, where he died of a stroke in 1979 at the age of 69. His remains were identified thanks to craniometry and a pathological hole left by a long-term infection in the maxillary sinus of Mengele's upper jaw. Mengele, during his first few years in Brazil, was afraid to go to the dentist because he was afraid of being discovered. So, because he was a physician, he would lance the abscesses with a razor blade and drain the abscess himself. He had an infected tooth for several years before he had a root canal done, and because of this, the infection was not treated properly for so long, It worked its way up into the sinus and drained out into the face through the hole in part of the cheekbone covering the maxillary sinus.
One of the most famous and the most media story related to forensic dentistry is the case of the tragic car crash, which took place in 2006 in Indiana, United States. A group of young people in the van were hit by a truck. 5 people died in the accident and only one girl survived, but she was taken to the hospital in the critical condition. Her facial skeleton was completely broken. Next to the unconscious girl, a handbag was found, in which there was an ID card of Laura Van Ryan. The bag really belonged to her friend, and the survivor was Whitney Serac.
Both girls had blonde hair and a similar body posture, and emergency service misidentified them. Laura's family was informed that their daughter is in coma, and after waking up may have problems with memory, and because of extensive wounds and swelling, cannot be reminded of herself. Whitney's parents refused to identify her body personally because they wanted to remember her as she was alive.
5 weeks after the accident, Whitney, who was taken for Laura, began to wake up from a coma. When she was able to speak, she was constantly correcting the hospital staff, referring to her as Laura, but it was considered that she was not fully aware yet. When the family realized that a huge mistake had been made, it was decided to take the anti-mort dental documentation from both of them and compare it with the dentition of Laura. The results of the analysis were unambiguous. Whitney Serac.
Certain morphological features of the teeth are known to show population variation, which can be used to distinguish the ethnicity or ancestry. These features, characteristics and occupational marks, give us an idea about the habits and cultural practices of a group of people. For example, the Aborigines, the Middle Asians, the American Indians and Eskimos tend to be large-toothed races with white crowns, while Lapps and Bushmen are small people with comparatively smaller teeth. Tailors, carpenters, and representatives of similar professions often keep needles and nails in between their incisors. Excessive tooth wear has been observed in the mining industry, associated with the large exposure to dust or acids in the work environment. The condition of the patient's teeth also reflects some diseases. Changes in subjects affected by rickets are based on the lack of formation of the enamel. Congenital syphilis causes the formation of barrel-like incisors with small crowns and nodular molars. Certain habits like smoking, tobacco chewing, or taking drugs can also leave their mark on teeth. In the United States, there was even a special term for advanced caries caused by the use of methamphetamine, metmouth. Dental restorations sometimes may indicate the ethnicity of the individual. Methods of restoration in certain countries or regions may be unique and may not be used at any other place. The use of expensive restoration may also suggest social and economic status of an individual. Very often, criminals leave bite mark impressions on the crime scene. For example, in food, chewing gum, or more commonly, on the victim. When a bite mark is found, forensic dentists have to take several steps. First, a forensic technician has to find the bite marks on the crime scene and take photographs. When the mark is sufficiently photographed, a saliva sample is taken from the area for potential DNA evidence. Even if the place where the bite marks were left does not allow for the reconstruction of the full dentition, we should remember that it may contain a sample of suspect's DNA.
The next step is preparing the casts or molds. Moreover, the odontologist can also assess if the marks come from a human, then the remains are a U-shaped mark with little canines. Dogs, they have narrow dental arches and leave expressive canine punctures. They can also come from an animal with different, 10 times the ones described. When a tooth or fragment of it is found at the scene of the crime, it is necessary to first determine if it really belongs to a human being. If we find a piece of jaw, a good anatomist can determine about its genetic origin. But if we only find a small piece, it is necessary to test it like blood samples, looking for a characteristic human protein, and then when we have access to that, we can determine whether it really belongs to a human. For individual identification, we can use DNA testing.
Rugoscopy is the study of the grooves and ridges of the palate. We can describe its shape, size, number, and position of the palatal cups, which are asymmetrical and irregular elevation of the mucosa located in the anterior third of the palate. This method can be used when identification by dental records is impossible or in case of edentulous mouth. The palatal rugae are well preserved even after third degree burns because of their anatomical position inside the mouth, which keeps them well protected and isolated against high temperature and more resistant to decomposition and thermal effect.
Forensic radiology is a method of imaging using X-rays. From the radiograph, we can compare morphological and pathological changes in dental structures. Crown and root morphology can be helpful in identification, for example, the presence of decayed, missed, filled, and fractured teeth. Stages of wound healing in the extraction sockets and degree of root formation, etc., etc. DNA methods. Dental structures are relatively more resistant to higher temperatures, heat, decay, and decomposition. It can also provide a source of DNA for easy identification. Due to an insufficient amount of material, the technique based on PCR or polymerase chain reaction can be used in DNA post-mortem analysis. Polymerase chain reaction is an enzymatic amplification of a specific DNA sequences, aiming to copy the sequence in the test tube. The method enables the distinction of the subjects among the others one with a high level of reliability, starting by 1 nanogram. Saliva is also a very useful DNA source due to the fact of being collected in a painless, non-invasive way and can be used even when it's storage and taken from poor condition, for example from the bite marks.
Another method of human identification is helioscopy, which focuses on the lip characteristics. There are variations in the lip layout and the lines of the fissures and the lips, which are unique to each individual, permanent and unchanging. And we can compare it. Of course, it may change because of inflammation, sores, or major injuries, but it's rather unchanged. In criminal investigation, lip prints visible through the presence of lipstick or fat can be found on glasses, napkins, cigarettes, and it can indicate a relationship between the subject and the scene of the crime and introduce a lot of valuable information.
Thank you.
A group of young people in the van were hit by a truck.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk.
Hitler in 1945 was 999.
Adolf Hitler's identity was.
Yeah, feel the beat of the tambourine. Oh, you can dance, you can jump.
Czekaj, trzymam.
Pasy jeszcze cię zapniemy, kochana.
Ja nie widzę tego sensu.